Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman. This is another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with Dan Taylor, and we're learning all about what we can do in the cloud. In a previous episode, we talked about snapshot debugging and debugging things in production. Now you're going to tell me how I can make things faster in production.
Right, so once your application is running correctly in production, you want to have a really good experience for all of the end users of your application, both the people who visit your website sort of on a daily basis, and then you know the odd customer might have some performance issues as well. So you want your app to be fast and responsive for everyone, and sometimes it can be very frustrating when you have someone come in and say, oh, the website was slow this one time, and you can't really reproduce that yourself.
In my experience, it's surprising how powerful the profilers that we have available are, and it is surprising how few people profile their code, like really sit down and find out where the hot path is.
Yeah, I think the views of the profiler are a little bit unfamiliar, and you kind of have to think performance a little bit. And hopefully, I can make that explain a little bit of how to do that. But really, the key is to know where you're spending time in code, and if you can figure out what function you're on the call stack for, the rest is usually the performance issue usually just falls right out. And I'll show a couple examples of that today.
Cool. You have some live demos?
Yeah. So I've got this this Fabricam site here. And this is an app that has been kind of hanging around Microsoft as a demo app for a while. And you know this, of course. And so I actually took this application. And I usually we go and we try and add a performance issue to the application to make it pop in the profiler. And for this one, I just decided to go in and say, this app has been around for a while. There's got to be some slow stuff in here. So I've got this service tickets page, and I went in and I did some analysis on this. So the prerequisite here is I've got this application set up with Application Insights, right? So if I'm going to go and look at the here's my Application Insights resource here in Azure for this.
Okay.
And so if I go to the performance view in Application Insights, right here. We've got the profiler built into this. So if you're an Application Insights user, you have to take one step here, and that is to come to this Configure tab here and just click the Enable Profiler button. And then we detect it's linked to the web app service that it's running in, and we install the profiler agent. And so what this does is it'll run a sort of system-wide profiler trace for about 2 minutes out of every hour. So random sampling in production.
Oh, okay, so it's not running all the time.
It's not running all the time, but it's sort of designed for scale. So we have people with up to 500 instances running internally, and at that sort of scale, the overhead is barely noticeable, and you always have constant streams of data coming out. So we like to think if you've got slow requests, eventually we'll capture them, and they'll just show up here in the
I see. Interesting. So if I had a one-person shop and I have a small site, it might not necessarily hit stuff.
It'll take a bit longer, maybe.
Because, it would have to be slow things happening within that window of time. Okay, that makes sense.
So rather than have to sit down and go in with Visual Studio or something like that and try and attach a profiler to your production environment, you just sit back and they'll show up on a regular basis.
Makes sense.
So remember that service tickets page there. So now that I've turned on the profiler traces just show up here in the performance blade next to the operations. So I want to point out a few different things before I look at the profiler traces for these requests. We show a few different metrics that help you, decide what operations in your application to look at. We have the count. So you might want to look at your most frequently visited sites if you want your homepage or pages that users are visiting most often to be fast. And we also have the median, which is the average or typical website performance. We also show you the 95th percentile, which says 5% of requests were this speed or slower.
Right, the outliers.
Yeah, so outliers without being true outliers, because some of the true outliers are stuff you really can't control, like disk swapping and things like that. So let's go ahead and click on the profiler traces for this service tickets page. So I'm going to click the view button there next to that one. It's got a median of 350 milliseconds and a 95th percentile of 568. So here it gives me the list of all the profiler traces we've collected in the last 24 hours. That's the current selected range of time here. And on the left-hand side, I get to pick kind of which individual example I want to look at. So it tells me that this 448 milliseconds one here was collected at 12 p.m.
Does this mean that there were only four, or is it just picking four good ones?
Four in that bucket, four good ones from that bucket.
Okay.
Right. And if you want to see all of them, you can actually come up here. And,
oh, okay.
And
so there could have been bajillions.
Yeah, we have obviously. We have lots. Right.
Okay. You pick some great yep. exemplars.
Yep. Yep. So the right hand side gives me sort of the breakdown for each. It's a call tree, so it's all the call stacks that were sort of, but over time, right? And so that's why you have a tree to navigate,
right? Right.
So any particular point in the tree kind of gives you, for this call stack, it gives you the total amount of time that was running mm-hmm. on the call stack during that request. And it also gives you sort of this execution timeline, this graphical view of one that was running from the start to the finish.
Right.
So I can see the ordering of things. For example, if I come down here, I see that there was a database request here that was about 1.53 milliseconds.
Not bad.
At the very start of the request.
Okay.
People always tell me it's the database that's usually the problem for the performance, but yeah. in this case, that's not true. But I'm just going to kind of look at the code here. And the thing that expands right out to the biggest sort of item in the list, which mm-hmm. is this handle entity append only item. And if I expand this here, it gives me, it shows me how much of this item was spent running on the CPU, which okay. is about 106 milliseconds of time.
Okay.
Right? And we're all about asynchrony with asynchronous web requests and things like that. But if you see time spent on the CPU, that's really bad for scalability.
Right.
Because only one person, one request can be using the CPU at a time.
How do you judge, though, that? How do you look at that and say, okay, CPU time, 100 milliseconds, that was a lot. Do you judge that based on, well, I know what I wanted it to accomplish, mm-hmm. and that number feels like a lot or doesn't? Is this your way of like saying you're in someone's for loop right here? Like
yep, what? Yep. That, so it really depends on what your goals are. Are you trying to serve a million people or 100 people that have a heavy workload? Mm-hmm. In this case, I know that this limits me to about 10 requests a second on the CPU. So for me, that I'd like to be able to serve maybe 100 simultaneous mm-hmm. users.
So you need to figure out how to do whatever work was being done when you hit slash service tickets.
Mm-hmm.
You need to go and dig into handle entity append only.
Yep.
What was its intent? What was that function's job? And do it in less milliseconds.
Right. So actually, the way I usually do this, and I've been working in performance a long time, and mm-hmm. this is sort of my go-to approach, is I'll just take this and I'll search for that function, and then type the word slow at the end.
Are you serious?
And then you end up in some blog post or Stack Overflow article here, because almost. Almost the most common performance issues, the one you're likely to run into, are ones that people have hit before.
That makes sense.
Right. So if I go to this article here and I read through the post, I'll save you sort of the reading here. Basically, this ended up being entity framework. It does a lot of change management tracking,
mm-hmm.
right? And if you notice this page here, it's got hundreds of it's got lots of items.
Oh wow!
Right.
I'm looking at your scroll bar. That's
yeah,
huge.
That's huge.
Maybe should have some paging.
Right, but we can actually make this go faster because it turns out this is a read-only query and I don't need to do all that change management tracking.
So I'm guessing you disable Entity Framework's change tracking.
Right, so if I just come into my code here, and this is what I learned from that post, I just put as no tracking and that cost will go away.
And that 100 milliseconds becomes 10.
Yep, yeah, exactly.
Interesting. I think that's funny that with all of your experience, and when you were saying I've been doing performance for many, many years,
mm-hmm.
so what I do is I type the function name and slow.
Right.
That's your secret? That's a really good secret, in fact.
Yeah, and I got one more example here.
Please.
I'll do the exact same thing. It really is about just identifying where you're spending that time in that code.
It really is.
And that's what the profiler helps you do.
Mm-hmm.
So if I look here, there's another 90 millisecond cost here, action link, link extensions action link. Should we do it again?
Yeah, please.
Action link, slow.
Oh, action link, very slow.
Right, and so they're saying, okay, I've got action links here and a tight mm-hmm. for loop.
Yeah.
And here's a tip here that if you generate an action link once and you use string substitution to replace the contents of the action link, you save a lot
so
of that time.
So you're generating action link in a loop and you had hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of them.
Mm-hmm.
You can do it outside the loop. And then just swap out the string
That's correct.
Inside the loop.
So
that's
actually,
a clever optimization.
And again, I didn't write this app, but then this is all stuff that I discovered by looking at this profile
right
here.
And this is nice because you could have come here with a demo that was like, and I made this slow on purpose.
Yeah, here's my four from one to a billion. No,
you found really slow stuff, yeah. Legitimately slow stuff.
And so there's that action link right there in a for loop.
In a for loop. So you'd pull it out, take the rendered HTML, and then swap it.
That's right.
Yep. That's very clever. Cool, I appreciate this.
Yeah.
The fact that I've got this also, I just want to say that even though there's great local profilers, there's third-party profilers, mm-hmm. there's built-in profilers that you can do on your desktop, mm-hmm. nothing is going to beat the reality of how it behaves in the cloud. And being able to see this in a cloud-based profiler has a lot of power.
Especially under load, too, when you have multiple users hitting the
site. That's a good point, under load.
And the convenience is I don't have to set it up and down, It just the profiles just show up for me.
Very cool. We are learning all about how to get code-level analysis of slow requests in production with Application Insights here on Azure Friday.